Hello, I am Chauncey Devega. You may recognize my voice from Ring of Fire Radio with Mike Papantonio, the BBC, SiriusXM, or the Tom Hartman Radio Show. And you may have read some of my essays at places like Salon and Alternate. I would like to thank all of you for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the eponymously named podcast known as The Chauncey Devega Show.
And they ran a story by somebody named Chauncey Devega.
Quote, I find black garbage pail kids, black conservatives, fascinating.
That's just unbelievable, you know.
He goes by the name of Chauncey Devega.
You know, I've been called Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout, shameless. But this is a new one.
Well, let's talk now to Chauncey Devega.
As my man Chauncey Devega of the blog We Are Respectable Negroes says,
I have author and blogger Chauncey Devega here with us.
Hello, and welcome to the Eponymous Name Podcast. You know the name. Say it with me, the Chauncey Devega Show. Lots to discuss this week. Fundraising week, of course. We'll talk about our annual. You know, I got to do it, folks. I'll do my NPR fundraising voice. You know, rather, I do our fundraiser twice a year. So we'll talk about that. I'll give you my little state of the podcast report. Preview some things that I would like to do in the near future. This will sound random, but I'm stretching. I got two jackets on and a sweater, because when I go out to work, I turn the heat off. And I got this crappy electric heat, baseboard heating. When I moved in here, they said, oh, you know, it works and it won't be that expensive. Yeah, my black behind. What heat's better? I think steam heat or oil heat is the best heat. Maybe there's someone who studies physics or engineering who can correct my misunderstanding about how heat works in an overpriced, cluttery Chicago one-bedroom apartment. So there's your visual, folks. I got the black cherry because when we're going to do some fundraising and talking about current events, sometimes, especially when you've had a bookend of violence this week and last, you had the Planned Parenthood shooter, then you had those two other ghouls who went to that center that helps disabled folk, our brothers and sisters and other government services out there in San Bernardino, California. Yeah, that was all day Wednesday. They're still talking about it. Folks love simple answers for their puzzles, don't they? Simple answers and simple solutions. But when the puzzle seems a wee bit more complicated, they don't know what the hell to do. So we'll certainly talk about that. Four great guests for the month. I'm stretching again because, like I said, I can't focus on this damn cold. Please, Jeebus, warm up this apartment. So four great guests for this podcast fundraising month. You know, I try to stack the deck when we do the fundraising because I want to always bring you wonderful folk. But sometimes you get the special guests. It's like you got the great meal, but you got the extra great meal. And that's what we got here on the podcast known as The Chauncey Devega Show. So the first of our four special guests this month, David Neiwert. You know him from Crooks and Liars, his great writing on eliminationist violence. You may be familiar with his work. He's been in many, many, many documentaries about right-wing violence, domestic terrorism, white supremacist hate, patriot groups up there in the Pacific Northwest. That's one of the ways he really got broken in after his many years of being a journalist, working in newspapers. He's been cool. He's been a friend of my work online since I started trying to get me that attention over there at Crooks and Liars, a great website that you should certainly check out. So he and I talk about the media, animals, justice, writing, his new book on orcas. Yes, the brother got a book on orcas. His newspaper time, how to write obituaries. And we just relax and we get in the Cadillac car and we go for a ride. We do that for about an hour. He does great teaching. He does great sharing. And you know what? I'm going to break. I like to hold on. I got to get the soda. Black cherry. I thought I would be able to resist given that it's cold in here and have some ginger tea. Not going to happen. So I'm going to hold it up so you can hear it. Hold on. This is our little special moment of soda rapture together because you know we both love the Shasta black cherry. So you and I are going to soda can open simultaneously with one another. And that will get the sugar in me. That will energize me, get my melanin heating up because, you know, the melanin stimulates heat. And we melanated brothers and sisters from sub-Saharan Africa across the Middle Passage in the Black Atlantic. We're here to be conscious brothers and sisters. See, that's my fake Afrocentric voice on the street corner preacher. So Let me open for us together. Hold on. Woo-hoo-hoo! You're going to get a sip. This is going to warm me up. This is going to warm me up. Hold on. Hold on. Mm. I already feel the sugar hitting my melanin. I'm starting to vibrate. I'm warming up, people. That poison does taste good on the palate. David Neiwert, great sharing, as I said. And notice how my voice changes when I get the soda in me, too. I may need to seek counseling. Maybe I have some sort of schizoid soda personality disorder. So we got David Neiwert this week for the fundraiser. Then, of course, another, I'm telling you, this podcast next week is even, gold, these conversations. But sometimes you just know you got something special top 10. These are all great conversations, but next week, some, you'll hear the tone, some of the just real and honest sharing. There's singing involved. There's a moment where the pathos, or is that pathos? I went to a public school. What was being discussed, I had to catch myself for a second. I'm going to leave that in there because that's what we call verisimilitude. That's the intimacy of radio podcasting. You actually get to hear how people are feeling. Serendipity, I got an email about a book that I had just gotten from the publisher, and I've mentioned it on Twitter. I mentioned it on the website. It is a must read. That book is called The American Slave Coast. And it is one of the most important, I'd say, up there with Edward Baptiste's new book and a few others, book written on the transatlantic slave trade in many, 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 many years. And sometimes it's going to be next week. As I said, I got an email from someone, a fan of the podcast, who had a witty, pithy email title that got my attention. Beautiful sister sent me an email saying, you need to have them on the podcast. And I said, sister down in New Orleans, already got it set up literally that day. So we talked yesterday in the midst of the shooting madness, and it's one of the best. It's top 10. That's gold. That's next week. See what I'm bringing you here on the podcast for fundraising month? Trying to bring you the best, interesting, compelling, smart people doing interesting and smart things. The week after that, Star Wars week. Of course, Bill the Lizard and I, we're doing a special podcast. Before we see the movie, it's going to be the first part. After we see the movie, it's going to be the second part. I will be at the premiere on Thursday. I will be there on Friday. I'm going to try to be there on Saturday, too. So that's going to be a little special podcast that week. So I'm giving you a twofer. Champion Joe Lansdale is back. He and I do another 90-minute Broadway, as they say in professional wrestling. Could have talked for 5 hours. That's the next episode. Great teaching and talking from Brother Joe, who gets in the Cadillac car and does his driving. See, I'm learning now, and I got Brother Champion Joe in the Cadillac car. I just sit back and he drives. We talked about martial arts. We talked about honor. We talked about his new book, Happen Leonard series, the new installment, which I'll be reading, getting an advanced copy. Appreciate that. Folks reaching out and hooking me up with that. And his new TV series based on those great books. And we talk about a lot of other stuff, too. We just go back and forth about some really interesting stuff. So that's number three. We had David Neiwert, American Slave Coast, Champion Joe. In the fourth week, I'm leaving as a wild card. I got three or four folks who would fit perfectly. Perfectly. And I'm just deciding whose it's going to be. So that's what I'm trying to do here for you guys. And as I always say in the beginning of the podcast, I said, fundraising month, it's always awkward, for me at least, to sit down and say, hey, you know, we got a begging bowl. This takes a lot of time. I actually did a personal accounting because I always have to take a step back and say, okay, cost-benefit analysis. I love doing this. There are opportunity costs. It's time-intensive. So I decided to write down every day for the last few weeks, because I don't like to BS anybody, how much time I actually spend between my online writing, online teaching, I consider them both types of public pedagogy, the podcast, doing interviews. I've done a lot of interviews these last few weeks because it's holidays, trying to catch up with folk. Because I said, we're creeping up on episode 100. It's coming. So if I get hit by lightning, hope it doesn't happen, or electrocuted, I told you how the damn electric oven tried to kill me last summer. Assuming it's not trying to plot vengeance on me. And everything works out. We already got 100 in the tank. So as long as they're edited and someone can find this portable hard drive, Bill the Lizard can. There'll be the posthumous episodes, the lost episodes of the Chauncey Devega Show. The black hard drive sitting next to my computer screen that folk can take with all the episodes on it. As I said, it's always awkward to have to ask, but it takes time. And you got to do the cost benefit. And that's not to say, hey, I can make $1 million. That's not going to happen. I wish I had a sugar daddy or sugar mama like that. Or it could be $100. Whatever it is, say, okay, I would do this for free. But the symbolic gestures matter a lot. The material gesture matters a lot. And the number I came up with on average was like 5 hours for the podcast, 5 to 10 hours for others. So sometimes a total of 20 hours if things are really crazy, in addition to having a regular job. You know, my other writing and research and other things I'm working, my zombie novel, still working on that. Champion Joe and others, as I said, they gave me some advice I've taken, you know, when I first started the project. Comic book, still working on that. And there's something else I keep saying. I'm going to do my state of the podcast in a second. again, we're on the precipice, people. Some things, good and bad, have been happening. Some lot of stress. And I want to thank my brother, Bill the Lizard, trying to help me out with that. And other people sending me positive energy and other type of support and offers of support. But that's life. We're going to make it happen. But we're on that knife edge, people. Some things I don't want to jinx. But if they happen, it's going to be a unique opportunity for all of us in this 7-8 year journey we've been on. So as I said, this fundraiser, here's the state of the podcast before we get to a little news analysis and then the great conversation about politics, Trump, authoritarianism, the media, newspapers, life, writing with David Neiwert. 7-8 years ago, we started this thing. I had no idea that I'd have these amazing opportunities to talk with the folks I do on the podcast. The podcast was a total lark. Folks who know how to find the lost episodes, I only put up the third season, which is now damn 60 episodes. There's about 16, 17 episodes before that, and I'm going back because I thought I could remaster those episodes, but they're just not salvageable, frankly. We did them over the telephone, said, hey, it'll be a supplement to what we're already doing. And, you know, sometimes when you ask yourself a question, you already know the answer. I knew I was going wrong with this thing because I love radio. Folks know my background in radio, something I hope I can go back to in a professional capacity at some point. I keep sending that out to the universe. Sirius, are you listening? Podcast one. Folks have actually emailed me about some of those options, by the way. They're saying, hey, have you thought about? So who knows what'll happen in the universe? So I knew I was going wrong with it. So all the great people I met on the podcast. So now about 7-8 years later, of course, metrics vary. Some people would laugh at these stats because they do it on a week or 2 weeks or a year. But we're coming up now, and I looked at all the different sources to get an average accounting. Didn't want to say too much or too little. But best guesstimate, 4 million page loads. Not bad. You know, that's a few thousand a day for about 7 years. Not bad. The TV stuff. If you see me on Tom Hartman last week, Ring of Fire, I'm going to be on another show next week. I'll do some shameless self-promotion for that. The thing that's cooking, it's serendipity, it's kismet. Brother Adelifu Nama, who's going to be on the show again, we keep trying to figure out our schedule, was joking about he and I doing Vulcan Mind Mail, talking about race and sci-fi. As he pointed out, it's kismet. So there's something in process that you will be able to see me more often. I was going to do it solo. Well, there may be a synergy that creates some other opportunities. So that's one of the things I want to do upcoming. I'm going to give you a little more detail on that. This is all the top of the head, as you know. I don't have I don't have a speechwriter for my state of the podcast or fundraising month. I think we did good this year. I'm still trying to manage using Twitter and Facebook because it's so important. And you're seeing my content at the website. But also, as I say, you know, I have that writing relationship with Salon and Alternet. So you see my stuff there, which is Salon, especially out of the blue. One of those things, because of you guys supporting me and me hustling over these years, that opportunity came to pass. So thousands of people, tens of thousands have been reading my stuff over there. Wonderful. So I'm trying to figure out, because again, I write for us and them simultaneously. If you got gold, you got to share it around. But I'm still trying to do exclusives for our website because we're family. So sometimes I wanted to be transparent and explain that to folks because I think some things are going on right now. I'm looking at the fundraising numbers. I think that changing the name of the website, looking at the traffic, we're a little off where we should be traffic-wise and fundraiser-wise, and I directly tie that to changing the name of the website. And I want to talk to folk about that for a second who've been with us for some time, or even new listeners. So we got the podcast, The Chauncey Devega Show. We had a website, still exists, WARN, We Are Respectable Negroes, but I had to change the name of the site to Indomitable. A lot of the back and forth on that, because the name, you and I know we're dealing with a joke. Inside joke across the color line about black respectability politics, the idea of being a Negro. No shame in being a Negro. I'm a proud Negro in the history of our naming practices. You can call somebody a Negro with love and call them black with hate. But it was costing me opportunities. And I think I left a lot of money on the table in many regards and opportunities because people would be like, oh, yeah, I'm down. What, we want you to come aboard for this project. Oh, we want you to come on the show. Your website's called We Are Respectable Negroes. And whenever you have to explain something, I was reading some stuff in marketing about this. If you got to explain it, it's probably not a good thing. So I made that tough decision. And I think looking at traffic, because traffic is down all over the blogosphere, but my Facebook traffic now is much, 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 much higher. Twitter is much higher. So people are commenting in different ways. And I think people have also realized they can follow me at Salon too. So the folks who used to comment more frequently at ChaunceyVega.com are either on Facebook or they're commenting over at Salon with thousands, hundreds of shares, comments, etc. But I do think changing the name, it's like Coca-Cola. It's the same Coke. But I think, and I can understand that. So that's my way of trying to encourage the brothers and sisters who may have gone away, a little hurt, invested in We Are Respectable Negroes, to say, hey, we're still the same. We're family. So trying to get them back. So I think that it sort of hurt the fundraising a little bit. We're a little off, and I have benchmarks I use. And so all the tedium for the fundraiser, I'm trying to explain to folk how this works in case you ever start your own website, how you can think about it, where we should be day one, day two, day three. So day three had a very kind donation from someone I'll be sending a thank you note to. Wonderful donation, actually, on day three. Day four, which is a Friday, you tend to see more on the weekend. Then it slows down. Second week's up and down around Christmas. People really become generous. So my plans, as I said, writing, working, trying to find that balance. Again, another opportunity. I'm so badly want to tell you what it is. And if it comes true, I'll tell you. If not, I'll tell you either way. So the plan I have going forward, of course, is I want to use the monies we get from this fundraiser, silver, gold, copper, pennies, positive energy counts too, after, I'm the worst fundraiser ever, after you take care of your friends, family, personal obligations, and pets. Include Brother Chauncey Devega in your Christmas, Hanukkah, is Festivus happening now? Eid al-Fitr, I think that already happened. Or just to support a brother. Send some love if you like what we do, because it takes a lot of time, opportunity costs. So what I want to do going forward next year, and if it's going to be raggedy, I ain't going to do it. You know me, best foot forward. I would like to start a video podcast, not to replace. No, we ain't replacing this, never. But at least once a week, I'm thinking something short, 3 to 5 minutes, because folks have asked me about it. And I get emails. They're like, hey, dude, why aren't you on the TV machine more often? I'm like, hey, I come on when I'm asked. I'm my worst manager, and I need a manager. I'm investigating. Anybody do talent development or experience in managing folk, hit a brother up. I need some help because I'm bad at this stuff. So do a video podcast. Once a week, 3 to 5 minutes where I'm either cutting a promo, a news promo, I'll call it, or connecting the dots, or I sort of do play-by-play on a happening news event or some news content analysis, because under fair use, we can use the footage. I did my research on that. We should be okay. Sometimes it'll be explaining a concept. Sometimes it'll just be something fun about popular culture, politics of popular culture, perhaps. But do that every, you know, week. And maybe, depending on what the setup is, record the intro and outro of this podcast. So when I put it up on YouTube as audio, because, you know, I put all the podcasts recently have been up on YouTube, by the way, and a lot of folks like that. Maybe integrate the video with that or record the whole podcast and get a cool setup. So need a decent camera. I'm going to get a used one. I'm not a Rockefeller and I ain't greedy. Ways to get good used cameras and get a green screen. I want to get the website professionally redesigned. That'll cost a little money. Not that much, given the way that web design fees have gone down over time. And get a logo or some sort of design done for the green screen thingy that'll be in the background. That won't be cheap. Maybe a grand or two if I'm lucky. If I can get it done on the 500, I'm going to get it done on the 500. But I've done my research about 1,000. So I don't like to give away what the goals for the fundraiser are. But I'm looking at that figure because that will allow me to get the video set up. Because I always tell you what I'm going to do. If we get over that, anything over what we need for the video setup is opportunity costs, relax, and recharge money. So some of that money from the fundraiser, I always tell folk when I do this, those generous people last December helped the brother out wonderfully. Get an overpriced airline ticket because these things cost too much damn money to go home for the holidays. See Mama DeVega because as it looks, I'm probably going to come in a little later because it's cheaper. But any help with that would be great. Surprise moms on Christmas. Go out for a decent dinner to recharge the batteries. And get a bottle of cologne. See, I don't ask for much, folks. My 20 hours a week in labor between the podcast and my various writings online. Because, again, I don't get paid for what I do at the website. And I do not get paid for what I do at the podcast. This is all love. There's no compensation involved. So that is me hands open saying I appreciate the love. Hold on. Hopefully I get into the fundraising sharing promo and I need another soda. I was on the train again. Now I'm warming up. See, the melanin is circulating. Ooh, black Shasta black cherry. Caffeine free. Naturally. An artificially flavored soda. One more swig before we do a little quick news commentary before we get to this great first podcast on the eponymously named podcast, another podcast, two podcasts known as the Chauncey Devega Show for Fundraising Month, David Neiwert. Hold on. Ooh, that was 4.5. Ooh, don't touch me, baby. That was 4.5 swigs. All right. Now I'm energized. I may go for a second black cherry for the outro to the podcast. And if I do that, don't tell my mama, please. Don't tell my doctor I'm getting high on the sugar water. So logistics that I forgot. So if you want to donate to the podcast, of course, you go to chauncedevega.com. Look on the right-hand side of the screen. You'll see the PayPal link. Click on that. Send a brother some love if you can. I greatly appreciate it. Small, medium, or large donations are accepted, and I would put it to wonderful and good use. Becoming, you know, more somber, more serious for a second, so we had those mass shootings again. And the problem with these mass shootings, I mean, there's so much you can talk about. And I'm sitting here saying, what do I talk about? Guns? Gun culture? Readily accessible firearms? Where you had these people in California who had like, it's something like 5,000 rounds of ammunition, and they had M16/AR-15s, which are military weapons. And you can email me, because trust me, I've done it. I can define what an assault weapon is. The AR-15/M16 is fundamentally the same weapon, people. You have people with military-grade weapons running amok, killing people. And the media, they want a simple story. And I'm leaning in for a second, so I'm going to give you a little insight into the thought process and pressure that folks who work in the news media, even as a mid-level person, I think I've risen from low-level to low-mid-level at this point. There's a low-mid-level person who's getting their hustle on and trying to figure out this life on the side, the side hustle. That increasingly looks like it's, in many ways, it may, if other things work out, become more of a main hustle. That you're under a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure to write things quickly and immediately and to be the first one there. The first is with the most, is right? They call that the hot take. Because you, if you're right, you get a ton of attention. And if you're wrong, yeah, you get some heat, but people really remember. So I'm watching this stuff happen the other day. And of course, they're like, oh, maybe it's white right-wing terrorists. Well, that would make sense given what we've seen in this country and the propensity for white Christian men to shoot people and blow them up. And we'll talk about the media framing. Isn't it interesting when you, I think only one media outlet actually did this to prove a point. You got that crazed white man, like these other crazy white men going around shooting people up, blowing up, killing them for their quote unquote politics or their God. Cause trust me, that abortion thing, that was about God. That was Christian nationalist violence. But the headlines never say Christian white man shoots 10 people. But I think it was the New York Post or New York Daily News, which is the more noxious of the two. I think it's the Post. I've actually written for the New York Daily News. Had a headline, Muslim killers or something, or Muslims kill. And you know, maybe it's the sociolinguist semiotician in me, the playing with language. It's fascinating how language works. Now think about this. What if the headline said, Americans kill? American dude, married to a woman from abroad. Or it said, Americans who happen to be Muslim kill. That's a different emphasis. Well, we don't get that, do we? Because again, the immediate move is to politicize all violence by Muslims. But how come we're not politicizing violence by Christians? The flavor shaver has been trimmed because I did that TV thing. But I'm on to an idea. Hold on. I wonder why violence by Christians isn't politicized in the same way. It's like politically neutral. You ever notice that? And we can talk about that. That's an act of politics too. When these right-wing sewer-dwelling Republican mouth-breathing gun fetishes, homosexuals. They don't politicize it. You're rushing to the fundamental purpose of the state is to ensure safety and security, but the citizens and its borders. There's nothing more fundamentally political than your citizens getting killed by guns. God, these people make me mad. But back to the flavor saver moment again. Hold on. Flavor savering. How could it be that when the Muslim does it, it's political, but when a Christian, well, maybe they'll say, well, maybe because we're at war with Islam and ISIS and Al-Qaeda. So all the Muslims are in it together. So that makes it de facto political in a different way. Well, maybe some sort of threat matrix thing. Maybe we can think about that way. But you know, flavor saver again, though. But the KKK, Christian organization, Christian right-wing dominionists, reconstructionists, and nationalists are killing people or advocating violence. But again, it's not political. Isn't it something to think about? Could it be maybe the problem is religion? Maybe that's the problem. Religion and politics together. Maybe all religions are at the root of the problem, and it's just a function of circumstance and time. And I know there's a qualifier. We don't see many Buddhists in this country or Jains or Sikhs or Baha'i going around killing people. So maybe it has something to do with a particular brand of Abrahamic faiths, politics in the moment. I don't know. But as we think about that pressure, right, so you see something unfolding, and it's like you got a cast iron pot. How about that? And you preheat it in the oven, and you don't think, and you just want to grab it with your hand, thinking you can do it for a second and put it on the stovetop, and you end up burning your hand pretty bad. There's a lot of pressure, because I was feeling it, to write something. I said, I got something I can say about religion or American identity or racialization and violence and guns. Maybe I'll write another open letter. And I said to myself, hold on, Chauncey. The merit of the hot take is you get a lot of attention. Some of it negative, some of it positive, especially when you're right. Like my hot take on Charleston Massacre, that's one of my best things ever. Got the attention it deserved. First is with the mostest. My quote-unquote hot take on the beat Black Lives Matter shooting, great, I think. The Laquan McDonald shooting, excellent. Ahead of the curve. But sometimes you follow your common sense and your better angels and you say, I'm going to wait to see what's actually happening because this is too important and their variables are too many and you could just be wrong. And it's something to look at some of the stuff that was written initially about these killers in California and how they're likely going to prove themselves to be wrong. But folks wanted to be first. Folks wanted to be there with the mostest. And as I hinted at when we started the podcast, you know, as I said, David Neiwert, is that you want to be right, but you want to be timely. And how do you think about it? So there's much to be said. And we want simple stories. We want a story about some radicalized man who's a Muslim with a radicalized woman. And they went and started attacking Christmas. It's a war on Christmas here on Fox News. But what if it's, here's a story for you. Anybody, I'll drop the mask for a second. I'm sure people have had this happen. You ever have like an experience at a job or your life where you're just pissed to hell and you want to quit, or the people are just giving you hell. They're bullying you. You have a supervisor who lies, who's making your life a living hell. And you're sitting there just fuming and you're just like, you know what? If I don't quit, I'm going to snap. I'm going to curse somebody out or do worse. Let's be real. And we won't do it. We won't do it because that's just not who we are, you know, but people snap. So here's a scenario for you people, because again, the media like simple, spectacular stories where they can talk about officer friendly and super cops with their SWAT teams and have experts on repeating the same damn thing 1,000 different ways, trying to speculate about information they don't understand. The same week that, I think it was last week, the Rainbow Six SWAT Team Special Forces video game came out. I mean, there's a whole, I'm actually writing about this, by the way, thing going on here with the spectacular 24/7 news media, digital representation, theater, and how the public is desensitized to violence. These scripts, we watch it and we're desensitized. And Officer Friendly is made into a super cop. Yeah, those militarized thug cops that you're praising because you're scared of quote-unquote terrorists. You know, they're doing the ass kicking on a daily basis against black and brown and poor people in this country. Officer Friendly, super cop, you love him. You love that monster when he takes out another monster, that wolf and sheepdog analogy, apparently. Yeah, and you like to clap and cheer, but when he's in your damn neighborhood kicking your teeth in and shooting people like that brother McDonald here or that video in San Francisco. You seen that video? Those thug monster cops surrounded that man and shot him, 8 of them, shot him all at once because he had a knife. You couldn't disarm this man. He had a little tiny knife, and you got guns out and you blast him. There's a whole conversation there. Oh, that black cherry gets into me, people. Whew, let me reset. So how about this? This man, Farouk, whatever his name is. What's his name? Farouk? Syed Farouk, something like that. What's this character's name with his those two ghouls who shot them people in California? So here's a scenario. Let's say the dude was at work and he's just disgruntled. It's workplace violence, but guess what? He's also being radicalized and pissed off and thinking about, you know, violent Islam. And the two come together. He's like, oh, you know what? I won't kill these people anyway. Now I got this other component to it, and that's added motivation. And I don't know if that Christmas party was causal or coincidental, or maybe the timing was just right. But the media wants either or. They want the sensational story as opposed to somebody who's just pissed off at work, who goes off, and that religion, that little bundle of religion, is the extra spark on something that was already going to blow up. See, that's complicated. Here's another angle. I'm sure they're going, the FBI and the CIA are all looking at Interpol. Dude, because you know my opinions about religion and how religion damages the mind. You know my opinions on this. Dude goes over to his pilgrimage, does his thing. Apparently, I was reading about this. He meets this woman. Totally changes when he comes back to get married in short order. Totally changes his demeanor, his dress, and his politics. So he meets a super religious lady, Muslim lady, over there in their pilgrimage. And she's giving him the poontang. Wearing him out. And giving him a little radical politics in the bed, getting in his ear. And he has to conform his beliefs to keep her happy. And that's how relationships work, folk. These ideas are infectious. It's like swapping pink eye or swapping some sort of the flu back and forth when you're French kissing. Swapping cooties back and forth. And they laying in bed and they reading their holy book, watching the news, justifiably upset, I think, in many ways about how Muslims are being treated in the Middle East historically by Americans and the West, but also how they treat each other, these corrupt governments. And she's giving him that poontang. And she comes home and she takes off her very modest exterior clothing and got that fancy lingerie on. And she got him turned out. And she giving him the poontang and giving him the politics. How about that for a story? But again, it all comes down to religion and politics, folks. And the media, the ghouls that they are, And I'm doing extended promo, can't help it. Because I think some of you were as offended as I was and disgusted by the way that the 24/7 news media was interviewing these witnesses and survivors, people getting phone calls from their loved ones hoping they're alive. And those newsies, you see, that's an old word, newsies. I learned that word from dime store novels and reading Roger Ebert's book. See, the newsie, yeah, they're human beings like the rest of us. Yeah, they're empathetic to a degree, but it's their job. You see, if it bleeds, it leads. Covering a story like this can make a career. And the more raw the coverage, the more empathetic or sympathetic they look, and the more dastardly and sad the story is in the framing, that could be a career. And I think some of them were just like, yes, mass shooting. Yes, I'm here. Yes, I've got the camera. Yes, let me interview these aggrieved, sad, crying people. There was one man crying on the TV. I should have turned it off. It was pornographic. That poor man crying because he found out his daughter was okay. And you're going to have that on the... I'm sorry. I just have standards about some things. Straightening my back. Okay. One more sip and we're going to have to transition. Hold on. So on this next segment, the podcast, David Neiwert, talking about eliminationist rhetoric, the right-wing media, violence, Donald Trump, newspapers, animals, psychology, anthropomorphism. We do the grand tour. It's a great conversation. I still appreciate him, as I said, because he's been a great supporter of my work. ChaunceyVega.com, supporting me at Crooks and Liars. I'm sure whispering and opening some doors elsewhere, because it is a very, very, very small world. And in a lot of ways, like I said, an advocate. And I think you enjoy the conversation. Relaxed, good sharing, some laughs, and going back and forth about obituaries. So next segment, David Neiwert, here on the first installment in our fundraising month episode of the Chauncey Devega Show.
This land is your land, and this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I went a-walking that ribbon of highway, and I saw above me that endless skyway, I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
So how are you doing?
I'm doing well. So, I'm on TV tonight. I'm going to be on the...
Oh, wow.
I'm on the Oxygen Network. I did a thing on, they had me down doing a segment on Shauna Ford, who was the subject of my previous book.
What was that like? I mean, how is it? I mean, certainly we'll talk about all this, and you've got all that wisdom. I want to thank you, too, for the kind email.
Sure.
We'll certainly talk about eliminationism and sort of the way that the mainstream media doesn't want to talk about this obvious fact and obvious matter. So I certainly appreciate it. I also want to thank you, too, Crooks and Liars, one of the first sites in the near recent past. I remember when I first started the blog and writing online, and it's like, wow, you know, CNL picked it up. And that was a great help. So that was a real confidence booster, too. So I want to thank you for that.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you bet. Yeah, that was one of the great things that CNL tried to do was help out the small local bloggers as much as possible. The motto's always been real generous that way.
You know, now that you have the perspective, obviously we'll talk about your books and all your other experiences, freelancing and TV and documentaries. Do you think the general public gets what's going on behind the scenes? Sort of thinking about the Wizard of Oz analogy and all the stagecraft and the, you know, not abusive narrative, but the way that, you know, propaganda works. I mean, there's white propaganda, black propaganda. Or are they just sort of succumbed to it? I often joke the masses are asses, and I wonder, is it cultivated or is it just surrender or is it learned?
Well, I don't know. I think a lot of people on the liberal side of the aisle are kind of in denial about it, to tell you the truth, about what it all means. But people on the right they're very much getting the wool pulled over their eyes, especially the working class people who are voting for these Republicans. It's pretty incredible how people can be convinced to vote against their own self-interest, all on the basis of this sort of cultural appeals, which is what, you know, the right's been doing for years. It's really kind of gone viral. I mean, you go out to rural areas now and it's just like it's an embedded, entrenched worldview that people have that, you know, this is the way people think. It doesn't matter whether it jostles up against reality or not. And it includes this view that, you know, Obama's a Muslim and that he's planning to enslave America, that he's secretly, you know, working on behalf of the caliphate. You know, this is stuff that was on Alex Jones just a week and a half ago. And the stuff circulates very widely and is picked up by a lot of people who are really credulous about this stuff.
You mentioned Alex Jones. I'm sure you've been on his radar. He gave me...
Yeah.
Apparently, I'm part of a black conspiracy with the gun grabbers to have a race war.
Uh-huh.
So as a student of right-wing politics, and
right.
I call, you know, the conspiranoid imagination, I told a friend, I was like, wow, Alex Jones has finally given me some shine. And he's like, be careful what you wish for, because his fans are crazy.
That was one of the things of Crooks and Liars that we always had to, we kind of tread carefully around Jones, because, yeah, he would, if he sent out the flying monkeys after you, it could be really painful. I mean, he could make your site crash and all kinds of fun stuff. So that's what we called it, too, was the flying monkeys, exactly what he would do. Let's put it this way. I expect someday to get flying monkeyed again, but I don't court it actively. but
isn't it scary, though, how our public discourse is so limited by this threat of abuse?
Yeah, no.
And then you say, okay, I want to tell the truth about this. But do I want to deal with the consequences of harassment or, you know, physical violence in some cases? And that's just, we talk about the Fourth Estate and its current, you know, state of affairs, and never mind citizen or activist journalists, but they really are thugs.
Yeah.
And like I said, you know, talking about the eliminationist rhetoric, you know, I wrote that piece on Donald Trump and I was opining on the website. I was like, I'm just shocked. I won't name the journals of record that turned it down. So I sat down, you know, you have that moment of inspiration. I'm going to write my 750 words that I know, fingers crossed, a mainstream publication will pick up because it ain't too long. And it's dense and it's readable. So I'm now at a point where I'm not getting automated denials from the editorial board, so I'm getting, like, the personal one. And I was like, I said, this thing about Donald Trump and that eliminationist rhetoric and talking about killing Muslims and these camps, I don't know if one journal of record ran an editorial condemning it.
Yeah, I don't think any of them did. I don't think any of them caught on to that this was something that was actually actively condoned at a major Republican rally. I mean, the guy... Look, you've got all you have to do is watch the video. Trump says, oh yeah, this is the question we need. He encouraged the guy. And he actively condoned what the guy was saying, rather than saying, that's just crazy talk. We can't go down that road, blah, 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 which is what it was, of course, and what any sane person would have said, but Trump's not sane. He's a demagogue. I'm glad you brought up the Fourth Estate, because what it reminds me is that this began, to me, the origins of all this is a sort of early form of bullying that we saw in dealing with the media back in the 1990s,
mm-hmm.
where conservatives would come out and claim that liberal media bias. I mean, this was the standard proclamation. A lot of it originated with Rush Limbaugh and so on and so forth, but it was something that was really... became almost a fetish in the newsrooms that I worked in. Of course, I noticed it because at the time, I wasn't particularly liberal, or I didn't embrace the progressive label as clearly as I do now. Considered myself more of a centrist. I voted a mixed ticket. You know, and I worked for a very Republican newspaper, right? And I was running their editorial page. But I think all of us were concerned by, you know, sort of the change in tone in the rhetoric. And in particularly, what would happen is if all you had to do is make factual reportage, what I noticed basically was that newsrooms became really chicken, particularly managing editors, city editors, publishers, those sorts of folks, the ones who were supposed to be your bulwarks against this sort mm-hmm. of stuff, were instead chickening out when members of the community would come to them and claim liberal media bias, you're being way too biased, and so on and so forth. And there was actually a period there in the 90s when most newsrooms were actively courting open conservative ideologues, whereas anyone who would dare to call themselves an open liberal was pretty much shown the door. And I wasn't shown the door because I wasn't really that, like I said, I wasn't that liberal at the time. But I very much became that way over time because after a while, I mean, if you believe in truth and factuality, that's where you gotta go. It's the same as with scientists. Scientists didn't used to be so nearly as liberal as they are now, mainly because conservatives have basically declared war on science.
Trying to be a good social scientist and all the literature out there about voting and political ideology and the old argument, right? Look at somebody's parents. That'll tell you their political values is relatively stable over their lifetime unless something happens. That old joke, you know, a Republican is a Democrat who got robbed.
Right.
And a Democrat is a Republican that lost their job.
Right.
So barring some big life change, because I've talked about this openly, and if I ever sit down or get a chance, do a memoir, and I've had some inquiries. That's the other thing I'm trying to figure out, too, is like the whole citizen journalism blogging and, you know, how do you sort of transform that into, you know, your first book project? Because, I mean, you have the insight there. I mean, you've written in so many formats, so certainly want to pick your brain on that. Mm-hmm. But I used to be closer to 40 now. I've been joking. I'll be 38 forever. That's going to be the lie I tell. I'll just keep dyeing my hair. But as a product of the 80s, self-described ghetto nerd, grew up with hip-hop, Star Wars, Star Trek, I was a black Republican.
Right.
And I'm a Colin Powell Republican.
Mm-hmm.
And my first vote, I voted for Bush, and I voted for Clinton. But there was a moment there where I looked at the Republican Party, and I was like, these people have lost their damn minds.
Really, the breaking point for me, to tell you the truth, was, you know, what was it, December 12th. 1999, when the Bush v. Gore decision was handed down. That was when I knew that conservatism had become a very cancerous element in the body politic, and I had to vote Democrat pretty steadily from then on, because it was the only way we could try to, you know, bring any kind of sanity back to our politics, because the Republican Party has just gone over the cliff. And so, yeah, I had a breaking point in 99, but prior to that, I think I was very much, growing up in Idaho, I was very much a middle-of-the-road Republican. But I was somebody who was also friends with, as a journalist, with people like Frank Church and Cecil Andrus. Because that was the kind of politics that was possible back then, right? And it's certainly not possible.
And would we ever have thought, maybe we sound like the old men yelling at the kids, that I'm thinking, you know, 92, 88, you had a choice between the first George Bush and Clinton later on. Now, whatever we want to say in hindsight about, you know, certainly new Democrats, neoliberalism, etc., neither of those men were crazy.
Right.
And I remember going to the voting booth saying, okay, our politics isn't broken. I couldn't possibly fathom the set of options that we have now in terms of how the Republican Party has basically broken normal politics.
Yeah.
And looking at their primary candidates, it, like I said, it boggles the mind, but I say to myself, okay, is this by design or is it just an accident of extreme polarization? Because the money classes always win. I mean, the plutocrats are laughing all the way to the bank because they don't believe in this stuff. You know, they'll use radical religion. They'll use conspiracy theories, anything to get tax cuts, and never mind globalization. But, I mean, if you were going to give the bullet point talk to, you know, a younger person, you know, somebody in their teens trying to figure this out, or somebody at the bar you're having a beer with, a stranger, how do you make sense of this mess? How did this happen?
Yeah.
You know, 10 books there.
I think you have to throw Fox News into the picture.
Yep, absolutely.
I think that they've been a profoundly toxic influence on society, and particularly on journalism. I think that the degradation of standards of journalism that I saw beginning in the 90s really kind of began with, a lot of it began with the liberal media bias accusation. And Fox was in many ways a product of that. They were fair and balanced as opposed to those liberal media.
Which is a lie, that they are fair and balanced because they're anything but it allows them to assert the opposite. Like the lie of the liberal media allows them to lie as conservatives.
Oh, yeah, it's a brilliant piece of propaganda. And that's what it is. That's what they are, of course, is a propaganda organ for the conservative movement. And, in fact, they kind of became the essence of the conservative movement in a lot of ways, even more so than, you know, I think before Rush Limbaugh had Poobah there for a long time, but I think he's been supplanted by Fox News. And that's where a lot of this stuff gets filtered through. A lot of the real radicalization that I've seen where ideas and themes and memes that generated in the far right of the militia movement and the patriot movement in the 1990s got shifted over into the mainstream was in many ways through Fox or its sort of secondary, you know, the right-wing media's secondary organs, including things like Washington Times and Newsmax and whatever right-wing media are out there. But Fox is really the leader in doing this. And one of the reasons I track Glenn Beck very closely, for example, during the years he was at Fox, you know, taped all of these shows for crooks and liars, because I really felt that what he was doing was generating a lot of stuff. He was taking a lot of ideas out of the very far right, out of the Patriot movement, straight out of it, and trotting it out there on mainstream television and using that as sort of counter to supposed mainstream left. But it was, you know, it was very remarkable to watch. And so that's been really a lot of the key to how eliminationist rhetoric, eliminationist attitudes get transmitted, is through these sort of mainstream entities that are taking ideas from the very far right, sort of refurbishing them and polishing them down and removing them, their rough edges, and presenting them for mainstream consumption. Fox has been doing that a lot.
And I mean, it's a great hustle, great in the sense of sort of the spectacular nature of it and how it's so refined. I was on Ring of Fire radio and Ring of Fire TV on free speech about a month ago, 2 months, talking about Dylann Roof. And I was pointing out the same thing. I said, you know, the right-wing media has weaponized its public. And it's, you know, some people said it's stochastic terrorism, but you give them the talking points, you create an alternate reality, you give them epistemic closure, then you turn them loose on the world, and they kill people, and then you do the Bill O'Reilly. Well, I didn't tell them to go shoot the abortion doctor. Oh, I didn't tell these gun nuts to go, you know, try to shoott police and firefighters. Oh, I don't know where Dylann Roof got these ideas from. And they have this, it's not even plausible denial because it's implausible.
Right.
But our media space is so polarized and so narrow that to speak a basic truth about Dylann Roof or about, you know, right-wing domestic terrorists who are overwhelmingly white and male, well, as you said, you know, going back to the myth of the liberal media, folks are afraid to touch it because they're afraid of the consequences. And it's
right.
Killing folks. I had an idea this morning. I was thinking, you know, we don't even know how many people the police kill in this country.
Right.
I mean, that's a whole separate conversation about sort of state power. But I'll bet money, maybe there's an epidemiologist doing this research, or maybe it's been done in a journal. I got to go to the university library later today and look it up out of curiosity. But given how polarized our public is and given the eliminationist rhetoric, I bet you there's been a lot of violence in people's homes and communities related to this, and it's just reported as domestic violence or reported as an argument.
Mm-hmm.
Because if people can't even talk online, I can't imagine what happens when they encounter each other in public. I think there's just a huge story there that's not being talked about.
Sitting around at a bar or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, I expect that's right. Part of the problem that these media are pretending that it's not happening. I mean, a lot of the reason, look, I think there's just this huge reluctance out there to actually confront what's going on. And that's why I think when we talk about eliminationist rhetoric, you know, when it's really kind of like, that's not pussyfooting around, really. That's getting right to the heart of the matter. And so talking about it is like not just prodding it, is like poking it with a sharp stick and rooting around, which is why I do it, because honestly, it's what needs to be said. If you know the history of this country and the deep history of this country and how this stuff came to pass, you know, how we got to where we are now, how we got to the demographic situation that we have functionally, even though we've had a Civil Rights Act in place for 50 years, we still can't seem to actually live up to it. Black people in this country are still functionally segregated into black neighborhoods, and there's no movement across the lines. And a lot of that, and particularly the continuing prejudice against young black men in hiring statistics, things like that, people are really in denial about that and about why it happens. Had this history of lynching that never gets taught in our schools.
Mm-hmm.
We have this history of sundown towns that never gets taught in our schools. We have the history of, I mean, just the history of what happened after Appomattox has been so grossly distorted that it's unrecognizable now. In fact, the real history has been largely turned on its head in terms of what kids are actually taught, because what they're taught is sort of a fake mythology that was written by Confederacy apologists. The whole idea that, well, blacks are able to govern themselves and so on and so forth. No, what actually happened was guys like Ben Pitchfork Stillman went on terroristic rampages and lynched hundreds of black people and white people who were trying to help them. A long campaign of terror basically enabled the South to win the war after the war. And, you know, we're certainly not taught that in our schools. So
have you had a chance to read Greg Downs' new book, After Appomattox?
No, I haven't. I haven't read.
Yeah, he was on the podcast about, you know, 4 or 5 episodes ago, and he writes for the New York Times. He teaches at CUNY in New York. And his new book basically talks about the military occupation of the South and the myths around Reconstruction and white racial terrorism. It's really a fascinating read. And by his estimate, he was citing, I think it was a senator giving testimony about the insurgency and the racial violence in the South after the Civil War. This is from memory. I think the number he came up with was something akin to several tens of thousands of black freemen were killed by white domestic terrorists in the aftermath of the Civil War.
You know, honestly, it wouldn't surprise me because so many of the deaths were unrecorded.
Oh, he's a great guest, too. I mean, yeah. Really, really generous. I mean, and his New York Times columns are great about the Civil War, so I'd certainly track him down. I mean, I think he's still writing them for The Opinionator. And, you know, I was thinking you have lynching, sundown towns, racial pogroms. And the one piece of it always gets me is we need to talk more and talk better to poor white people in rural America. Because, again, I'm sure somebody's researching it. The police violence we see in America's inner cities, I bet money that you're seeing similar types of violence against the white rural poor.
Yeah.
And never mind the violence on against First Nations communities that's never talked about. Apparently, I was reading an article that said that First Nations men are subjected to more police violence disproportionately. I mean, the whole stat about unarmed black men like more likely to be killed than whites in the same situation, that First Nations are suffering even more. And they're totally invisible to the in the political discourse.
And, of course, some of this has to do, I mean, some of this, honestly, is urban liberals can be pretty damn snotty about the rural poor. They tend to look down on them, being uneducated. And believe me, they all know it. You know, and this is part of why they're susceptible to these culture war appeals, because they know that there's people out there that look down their noses at them. And to some extent, that's true. It's not as true as they think it is, but it's true to some extent. I mean, I know plenty of folks living in the city who say all kinds of nasty things about poor rural whites. And honestly, some of those poor rural whites have it coming. But being from a poor rural white family, I mean, my sympathy is with working class people, generally. I also know that we aren't going to solve any of these problems by dividing up and by race.
Yeah, I went to Democratic Socialist, I guess it was the American Communist or Democratic Socialist conference that was here in Chicago. So I had a chance to go there for free. You know, some interesting panels. I was joking on the website and some friends. I said I was thoroughly denounced by some socialist women as being a capitalist misogynist who was too dressed up, and he thought he could pick up socialist women at the conference. So I was complimented and insulted. So to my face, which was fascinating.
To your face.
So I walked by. I'll never forget. So they insulted me, and I smiled like, thanks for the compliment. And then I went to this great panel about the rural poor Appalachia and coal country and sort of race in coal country. And I learned that, you know, you had all this migration, apparently, from Appalachia to cities like Detroit and then Chicago. And in the 50s and 60s and in the, I guess, late 40s, too, they had all these newspaper articles basically talking about white Appalachians basically using the same racially derogatory terms as they use for black people. Because, I mean, they were subjected to police brutality. I guess Detroit actually passed a law protecting the civil rights of Appalachian whites because they were being so abused by police and discriminated against in the housing market. And I'm listening to this discussion. They're showing the slides, and they had a story from, I guess it was the Chicago Tribune, and it said something like, intrepid woman journalist goes to den of vice of Appalachian savages. And about how all they do is they drink, have children out of wedlock, and they're just, you know, the same stereotypes of the undeserving poor that you hear today.
Right.
You could just use that to make those connections. You've written about so many topics. I mean, you've had a hell of a career. I mean, how did that happen for you? Was it just a series of accidents, or was it a series of, you know, strategic choices, or both?
Well, a combination of both, yeah. A lot of it is that I wanted my subject to be where I live, which is Pacific Northwest. But I wanted to write about stuff that was important. I figure if you're going to be a freelance writer, you might as well write about stuff that's worth writing about, right? Probably going to suit you better in the long run. And here in the Northwest, in the 1990s, one of the big things was, well, I mean, I was an environmental reporter. That was kind of my background in newspapers. But I'd had if you were come up in small papers, you have to be a jack of all trades. You have to be a photographer. You have to be able to do pay stuff. You have to write the obits as well as write the editorials and cover the local sports teams too. And that was kind of my background, that I was very versatile when I started freelancing in the 1990s, I did it primarily as an environmental reporter. And so I did, one of my tracks was that I started writing about because it was a fascinating story was the killer whales we have here in the Northwest. And then at the same time, I started writing about these militias that were organizing in the early 90s here as an anti-environmental backlash story. And so then when Oklahoma City happened, I was one of the only reporters who'd actually talked to these guys, right? So I became militia expert and and was featured in lots of interviews. And, you know, I'd already had kind of running relationship over the years with the SPLC, Southern Poverty Law Center, because of the fact that I had to cover a lot of this stuff over the years. You know, we always had Aryan Nations and the Order and things like that floating around in our background. In fact, I used to get letters to the editor when I was the editor of the little paper in Sandpoint, Idaho. I used to get letters to the editor from Robert Matthews, who later gained great notoriety as the leader of the Order, which was that the neo-Nazi gang that robbed all those banks and shot Alan Berg. I don't know if you remember the case, but that all happened back in 1984, and people have forgotten about them. I remember very clearly because I used to get letters to the editor from Robbie. Never ran any paper, but I kept a file of them. They were really nasty stuff. Those were the kind of things in my background, so it came very easily and naturally to me to write about the far right. Over the years, I just had a lot more of that work to do, and I maintained a thread of writing about killer whales because I just found that story interesting. I've stayed in touch with all of my sources. And honestly, I would go up camping and go kayaking really as much as a spiritual balm from dealing with hate groups after a while. You know, it's nice to get away and just feel the lapping of the waves. And
because you got to maintain that balance in your own mental health, phrase called racial battle fatigue. The psychologists have come up with. And there's a really powerful piece written by an African-American journalist. I think he's in Baltimore. I don't know if he wrote under a pseudonym or not because he didn't want to get harassed out of his job for telling the truth. And he basically wrote about the tedium and exhaustion of writing about racism and classism and all these bad things and what it can do to you psychologically and mentally.
Yeah.
And it's so important, you know, to maintain your peace of mind. And folks who've met me in the real world as opposed to the virtual world, they're very often surprised. They're like, number one, you sound like you write. And I was like, yeah, I'm always trying to be myself. You know, I think you just are yourself with the volume turned up. But, and they said, you know, it always starts with like, you're not miserable or angry. And I was like, no, I'm not walking around 24/7 as some stereotypical miserable, angry black man because I happen to care about social justice and the common good. But it can really, but I've met folks who are just sort of broken by, like you said, either writing about right-wing terrorism or domestic violence or sort of the ugliness of the world. You know, if it bleeds, it leads. And they take that stuff into their heart, and it can sometimes kill them. They commit suicide, develop, you know, other coping mechanisms, drugs, alcohol.
Very, very easily. Well, so after, I mean, my most recent book before the current one, which is the Killer Whale book, the book before that was a book about the Shauna Ford case, but really it was about the Minutemen and nativism in America and how these far-right movements are fundamentally in themselves sociopathic. And so naturally they just attract a lot of sociopaths, a lot of people who are just like the worst of humanity. And Shauna Ford was certainly one of them. The thing that was striking about it to me, of course, was that people are the core element of what makes you sort of so psychopathic is having a complete and utter lack of empathy. And
that's right.
Began thinking about it, and one of the really cool things about killer whales is that their whole societies, their culture is based on empathy. They're profoundly empathetic animals. So it was a lot of fun to actually kind of contemplate, you know, well, here's what killer whales have to offer us as sort of counter to just, I mean, a lot of the work that I do writing and reporting on the far right is somewhat defensive. I think it's sort of a way of alerting people and informing people ahead of time so that they can defend themselves against this stuff. But I also wanted to think about ways that we could get out of this trap because I do think politics built on empathy.
Yeah, I remember reading, I don't even know if it's still published, back in the 80s and 90s at the Yale Co-op bookstore, back before they ruined downtown New Haven near Yale. And he used to hang out. He was a friend of my father. My father always wanted to make sure I met interesting people. So he's since passed away, this gentleman. But he was one of the Black Panthers in New Haven who was part of the trial for trying to blow up, the Malley's department store.
Yeah.
And he would hang out outside of the Yale bookstore and Cutler's Music, and there's, I'm giving a visual for folks, Broadway Pizza, Educated Burger, all there on that street on Broadway. Because my parents let me take time off of school, because I found school really boring.
Uh-huh.
Cool. So it was like one day I just didn't want to go to school. So I would sit with him, and he would show me Z Mag, and we'd read and talk about stuff. And I remember reading an article about the white supremacists who had infiltrated the U.S. military, and how, like, at Fort Bragg, it was so bad. Like, they had separate barracks for white nationalists and white supremacists. And they were fighting and killing each other. They'd infiltrated the special forces, etc. And then there was another piece, probably in another issue, about the Pacific Northwest and these white supremacist groups. But, I mean, for folks who don't know that history, can you sketch that out a little bit? Because I don't know how much the general public knows about the tensions between the environmentalists and the white nationalists and white supremacists in the Northwest, and then bringing it back to McVeigh. Because that McVeigh story, again, is a landmark in terms of domestic terrorism, has basically been thrown down the memory hole.
Yeah, it's funny how in Oklahoma City, even, they seem to have forgotten him. It's bizarre. If you go there now, they're so far to the right. Well, back in the late 1970s, we had an organization called the Church of Jesus Christ Christian of Aryan Nations move up from Southern California to Hayden Lake, Idaho, which is there in the panhandle. It's about 10 miles north of Coeur d'Alene, pretty little suburban town. And actually the compound, the place that they bought, was outside of the town itself. It became a center for just an amazing, it became this huge magnet for all of these people to move to the Northwest. And they specifically recruited as, we're going to try to build a white homeland in the Northwest. And so they recruited people from all over the country to move to the panhandle of Idaho. And frankly, they did. I mean, the panhandle of Idaho used to be blue. I mean, it had a long history of being very liberal. And in fact, it was the, you know, Wallace, Idaho was one of the birthplaces of the Wobblies, for God's sake. Huge, long history of labor activism and so on and so forth. And it was Northern Idaho that got Frank Church elected year after year, you know. That all changed. It all went away in the aftermath of Aryan Nations moving there, because even if people weren't necessarily racist, they got the message that Northern Idaho was a friendly place for white people to move to. So we got huge amounts of white flight into Northern Idaho during the 1980s and 1990s from places like Orange County and Arizona, people who were trying to flee the brown people who were moving into their neighborhoods. And that was really had a long effect. We finally, Southern Poverty Law Center finally put the Aryan Nations business out of business in 2000. And they'd been trying for quite a long time, but in the 30 years that or so that they were there, it was just a regular font of criminality and radicalism and just headaches for law enforcement, a black eye for the community. Northern Idaho developed a reputation as a haven for racists, and frankly, it's never lost it. So, and that was very much, you know, the background that I went into it with. So in the 1990s, when we saw militias organizing in the Northwest, and they were organizing, claiming that environmentalists were plotting to round up. I mean, these far-right groups always run on conspiracy theories, right? That's their raison d'etre, practically. Their favorite conspiracy theory was that liberal environmentalists and ecology types in the United Nations were plotting to round up all the conservative gun owners in America and put them into concentration camps in the Cascades. And they had maps showing where these concentration camps were being built and so on and so forth. Very much a precursor to the FEMA camps that we hear about today. And indeed, within a couple of years, I was covering FEMA camp theories in 1996, which is about the time I think Alex Jones picked up on them. So,
and what's the genesis? As a fan of conspiracy theories, and you know, I had Joe Yusinski on. He's a political scientist. Actually, he and his co-author wrote a book about conspiracy theories and public opinion in American politics. What was the genesis of the FEMA one? Because again, folks were probably laughing at folks like us, you know, who are interested in conspiracies, who monitored the right-wing media. I'm still, you know, I don't like the new host. I remember listening to Coast to Coast AM and, you know, right-wing talk radio in the 80s and 90s, you know, from midnight to 5 a.m., because I loved Art Bell. I think he's one of the greatest radio hosts of all time. But you would hear these ideas that then became mainstreamed, and you'd hear them on Fox News a few weeks later or a few months later.
Right.
But I remember the FEMA camp. What the hell was the genesis of that? I mean, was there, you know, because the military was downsized and they were building camps to store equipment, that people just put that into their pre-existing New World Order stuff?
No, it really was very closely tied to the whole thing with black helicopters.
Yep.
And people were observing supposed United Nations troop movements all around the country. They were taking photographs of military carriers on railroad cars and that sort of thing and saying, see, they're moving troops everywhere. But really, it was just harmless military stuff. Sometimes there were exercises that took place with other countries, and they would be moving those military military equipment around as well. But it was all quite harmless. it was all shades of Jane Helm, right? That was the most recent iteration of the same thing. It's just they're seeing black helicopters, they're seeing fences built everywhere. Oh, that's going to be for a concentration camp, we found out. I remember one of them that I looked into in the 90s when we were hearing that they were plotting to build concentration camps. I went out and looked at the property itself. It was a wildlife fence, a sort of a game management fence that was designed to keep the elk from getting into farmers' fields. And they were saying it was a fence precursor to a concentration camp.
And if they want to look for, you know, they're not concentration camps per se, in the classic sense, but they share some frightening overlaps. I mean, they're worried about FEMA and worried about the United Nations. They need to look at the American prison system and the percentage of black and brown and poor people this country incarcerates. I mean, America is the world's largest carceral society.
Oh, that's right. No.
Look at Rikers. That's a gulag.
That's the crazy thing about all of these conspiracy theories is that they're shiny distractions from the conspiracy that's going on right in front of our faces and is happening very openly. And that is the conspiracy of wealth to maintain the status quo racially and otherwise. And the conspiracy, you know, is basically the conspiracy of wealth to keep their thumb on the rest of us. And that's just something that we know is going on. It's something that happens right in front of our faces, but we don't confront it because we're too busy being distracted by these bright and shiny objects, such as United Nations is plotting to take your freedoms away. No, Tide, or, you know, some of the, you know, these corporations that are plotting to take your freedom away. For God's sake, you ever work for a corporation? You have zero freedom when you work for a corporation.
And never mind they're trying to get patents and copyright. They may have actually done it. I think Microsoft is trying on human DNA.
Yeah.
Never mind what Monsanto is doing. But could it be with the conspiracies that it's like chasing that white rabbit, that the appeal of this is that they'll never get an answer? It just becomes more complicated. Whereas if they actually wanted to look at the real world and look at empirical reality, the facts are self-evident, and that's not as exciting. So these personality types need to just keep chasing that rabbit, knowing they'll never catch it, or it's a riddle within a riddle within a riddle,
yeah.
And that just occupies their minds.
Oh, yeah. No, it's much more fun to make it a sort of thought game rather than confronting the reality, because reality means that you have to work hard. I mean, if you want to make a change, guess what? You got to get down, buckle down, and actually work. You have to get involved in democratic institutions and actually be engaged in a way. And maybe the change you're going to make is just very incremental. But that's how change actually happens in a democracy. It doesn't happen with these magical waves of the wand that the conspiracy theorists and their sort of magical thinking want to believe it does.
They want some sort of, you know, Manichaean politics, but
yeah.
As a fellow animal lover, as someone who's fascinated by animals and biology and their psychology, I'm looking at your Skype profile, the orca or whale, and I remember that horrible movie. It scared me to death. When did it come out? The early 80s? Was it called Orca? What was it called?
It was 76, Orca the Killer Whale, yeah.
There you go. It scared me to death because they would show that movie, and they showed this other movie that just made me cry because I love dogs. I've always had several dogs as pets. Right now I don't. I have to rectify that. It was called, what's it called? White Dog? about the racist dog.
Oh, yeah.
Who was trained, and then at the last scene, was, this wasn't Morgan Freeman, it was Paul Winfield, I think.
Yeah.
That it attacks him, and he's rehabilitated this poor animal that was a victim. And there's a lot of history to that, too, with slave catching dogs, where they'd actually take dogs right. and have black slaves beat them, or black freemen, whoever they could find is black, beat the hell out of these poor animals, and then they would turn them into slave hunting dogs, or police dogs later on. But how did you, you know, tell us about your number one, the book about orcas, but how did you sort of come to that love of animals and discovery? Because, joke before, if I suddenly die in my cramped Chicago apartment, they'll find, like, bags of old bread that I take to feed the birds and be like, he was a hoarder. He was hoarding bread. I just want the world to know it's to feed animals and squirrels. But how did you sort of discover your love of animals? I mean, was it just growing up with animals and nature? Or you just want, like, you know, the observation about their intelligence and the fact that we know so little about the minds and communities of animals?
Yeah.
And their societies, I mean, you know, killer whales, dolphins, others, primates, they have societies, they have rules, they have norms, they have culture.
Right, right. Well, yeah, I did grow up with animals, didn't really have, I would just say a lot of it just came from time spent around these animals and being impressed by them. I mean, let me tell you, it does change your life to be in a small kayak and have a 6 foot fin belonging to a 12,000 pound animal that can smash you into smithereens, come lumbering towards you out of the fog, and they know exactly where you are, and they're just like checking you out, and they could kill you, of course, with the wave of their flukes or a little bite of their rather large jaws, but they never have. Killer whales have never actually killed a human being in the wild. They've only done so in captivity. Despite what happened to Richard Harris in that movie. and no, Charlotte Rampling is wrong. They do not have a well-defined sense of vengeance. I love the scene where he bit off Bo Derek's leg myself.
Now I have to go back and watch it on Netflix and see if it was as horrible as I remember.
Oh, it's actually, they should do a Mystery Science Theater 3000 of it. It's so bad, it's just hilarious. Especially what we know about killer whales now. My other favorite scene is the one where the orca raises his head above the water and roars like a lion. Which, that's not a sound I've ever heard an orca make, but,
We could have that movie, White Dog, and what was the other one about the rabbits? The Day of the Triffids or something? Or Night of the Triffids about the giant rabbits?
Oh yeah, yeah, that's right, Day of the Triffids, right.
Three movie marathon of bad animal theme monster movies.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, Orca was an attempt to rip off Jaws, and they made a lot of those. There were a bunch of Jaws ripoffs, but none of them were very successful, thank God. And Orca is just hilariously bad. So, you know, a lot of it was just when you see the animals themselves. I mean, the film that I think everyone should watch is Blackfish, the documentary about orcas in captivity.
Yeah, I can't watch it because I'll cry and get angry.
Yeah, yeah, it's perfectly understandable. I'll just say it has a redemptive ending. You don't walk away from the movie. You may be angry, but it's not depressing. but it is, it very much lays bare what goes on at these marine parks and how wildly inappropriate it is to have these animals in captivity. They've been around the planet for 6 million years, and they evolved the way they did for a reason. And part of the way they evolved is that they swim constantly. They'll swim up to 100 miles a day. And putting them in these little tiny pools, these concrete tanks, is just...
It's just inhumane.
Yeah, it's just torture. And then on top of that, you know, what we now know about the echolocation is really just mind-blowing about the ramifications it has for them. Because these are animals that not only can see every object in the water, they see inside every object in the water, including each other. And what we now know about their echolocation faculties and where the centers are in the brain, they're very close to the emotional learning centers, and they have a lobe that is not present in humans called a paralimbic lobe. We don't really know what it does, but it's what's pretty clear is that these animals, not only their sense of themselves is actually extended to include the other members of their pod. Their sense of identity is very different from ours. So their daily lived lives are very different. And their sense of empathy is truly profound. So, you know, those are the kinds of things that we think about. And it's important to not put them in these tiny little tanks where they can't even use their echolocation.
I mean, another parallel, like, I don't believe in circuses. If I ever had kids, I wouldn't bring them to circuses either, or my mother and father. Also, we don't like zoos. Zoos are amazingly depressing places, in my opinion, to see these beautiful animals confined like this. And the elephants, I tell folk, whenever, you know, I see an elephant rebel because it's realized it's no longer chained up and it chases down the trainer and stomps him to death, I always root for the elephant.
Yeah.
Elephants are profoundly intelligent and wise creatures, and if they're killing somebody, they're killing them for a reason. Culture of elephants and their memory and the way they communicate and shared culture. They have funerals, their levels of empathy. Yeah. But what about the detractors who are listening to us talk about our fellow inhabitants of this earth? And they'll be like, oh, Chauncey and David, they're just anthropomorphizing. That the killer whale, he came up to the boat or the kayak, and he was thinking of eating you and decided you weren't appetizing, and he doesn't care that you were there. I mean, how do we silence those critics or rebut their claims?
Well, honestly, a lot of the reason I took on the subject of orcas is that they, of all animals, really kind of test that whole line with anthropomorphizing, because they are so much like us in so many ways. And particularly, you look at those big damn brains that they have. They're, you know, it's the second largest brain on the planet. It's the most gearified brain, which is to say it has the most cortical folding of any animal on the planet by a factor of about 4. So really remarkably intelligent. And this idea, I'm in same line as the climate scientists who are fierce advocates for combating climate change. If the people who know what the deal is can't advocate for it, can't speak up, then nobody can. And all that I'm doing is, you know, I'm speaking up as somebody who's knowledgeable about what these animals are about. It's not anthropomorphizing. It's just that I know that this is what they're doing. We can show this scientifically, and it has been shown scientifically. This is what they're doing. I don't think of it as anthropomorphizing. I think of it as empathy, honestly. And honestly, a few more scientists could use it.
I mean, I forgot enough. It was Misha Kalku who said that, theoretical physicist. He said something akin to, human beings know more about outer space than we do about the deepest parts of the ocean and all the other types of animals and intelligence we share the earth with.
Yeah. No, that's true.
You know, we're looking outward and we're not looking at the things right in front of us.
Right, right. We're looking for signs of intelligent life on other planets, and we actually have one right here. That's right. Yeah.
But when you see, like, you know, since you wrote the book on the orca / killer whale, what's the correct name? Is it orca? Is it killer whale? Is it
both? The scientific name is killer whale. That's the name the scientists use. Latin name is Ursinus orca. And that's a species name, and a lot of people just call them orca for short. But it's either one. I think I consider them interchangeable. Certain whale advocates don't like using killer whale because they think it's unnecessarily negative towards the animal. I don't think it is necessarily. I mean, yes, the killer whales that I see and that I deal with, they're salmon eaters. They're very gentle. And they've, like I say, no killer whale anywhere on the planet has ever harmed a human being. But are they killers? You can't stray. They're very efficient killers. So let me tell you, there's a second population of whales out here called transient, and they eat seals and sea lions and things like that. When they grab a seal, it's not pretty. You know, they kill them pretty quickly and mercilessly, and they eat them up. They do it. They eat humpback whale calves. You know, I mean, these are animals that are pretty omnivorous. They've even been seen eating moose.
Wow.
Yeah, because they're moose that will swim between the islands, Alaska and BC archipelago, and they've been observed on two different occasions taking those moose down.
I mean, wonder, you know, maybe in our far future or near future, we'll have the technology to communicate and, like on Star Trek, come up with a universal translator, because I have the cartoon drawn in my mind of the orca looking at the moose saying, he tastes like chicken. Like, I want that.
Yeah.
I don't want fish today. I want that. You see these videos online? They go viral with the whales or dolphins or other dolphins and whales going up to people for help when they're injured or when they're trapped in nets.
Yeah.
And then they come back and they swim and they jump. Again, going back to the anthropomorphizing point, are those killer whales and dolphins and other our animal friends in the sea who we've observed seeking help from humans, is it just random that they happen to bump into people? Or have they communicated and taught their children and each other that humans can remove these nets from us? I mean, is it intentional behavior or is it just an accidental encounter? I mean, how do you make sense of that?
I would guess it's accidental and they're just desperate. I don't think that they know that humans can do it, but, you know, when you're caught in those nets and you're trying to stave off drowning, you probably seek help in any form you can. So I imagine that that's all they're doing. You know, if they thought a shark could help them, they would probably seek them out. It is an interesting phenomenon that they are starting to seek us out now. It's kind of a new thing.
Or even all the stories you hear about dolphins saving children from drowning or dogs get lost
yeah.
and they push the dogs ashore. I mean, you know, the dolphins are fascinating to me because,
sure.
you know, there's a great book. I want to get the titles right. I think the first one was The Orangutan Who Liked to Wear Clothes. And I think the other one is The Octopus Who Liked to Hide Things.
Uh-huh.
It's all about animal intelligence. It's written by an animal behavioralist. And one of the parts I remember about dolphins is they're like, yeah, dolphins are extremely intelligent. But dolphins like people because with intelligence comes the capacity for barbarism. They hunt, they kill for fun.
Yep.
They rape, they bully each other,
yep.
and maybe they are helping people, you know, because the movement looks like one of their own in trouble, or maybe they are helping a dog that's drowning because the movement is familiar. But they're like, you know, with that intelligence comes a capacity for a whole lot of mischief.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. I think it's kind of interesting, actually, that killer whales, as opposed to dolphins, of course, they are the largest dolphin, but as opposed to, say, bottlenose and other dolphins, killer whales don't exhibit that kind of troublemaking behavior except when they've been held in captivity for a long time. But in the wild, there's very little of that that ever happens. And of course, although that they do, I mean, obviously the mammal-eating killer whales eat all kinds of things and play a role in nature. Some of it's important.
You know, as we wind down, because I know you're pressed for time, and I was thinking of where I started. Because, you know, maybe it's my own selfishness, respect, or curiosity, probably all three. You know, thinking about, you talked about freelancing, and you've written books, and been TV, guests, and, you know, documentaries and the like, to, you know, worked at Crooks and Liars. What's your broad take on sort of thinking about, for the listeners to the podcast, because I always try to give folks deliverables, because a wide range of folks listen, myself included. What are some, you know, some life wisdom or career advice you have for folks who are trying to navigate, you know, either being a freelancer or getting that first book contract or trying to figure out TV or their orient their career? Because this really is, because of our broken economy, you know, an age of freelancing in so many ways.
Right.
Where people are trying to be independent contractors, or they can write if they're interested in the news, or they're trying to monetize their online presence and develop a brand. What are some things you've learned or advice you wish you had taken or things you wish you had known?
Well, I wish I had known that people don't really want to read about hate groups, but...
Practicals. Like, well, there goes that great idea.
Yeah, no, I mean...
I'm going to be paying the mortgage with this one.
No, yeah, I mean, the book about the Minutemen just died totally at the box office. And honestly, as you mentioned, I actually got to enter a sort of depression after finishing that book because it was an awful story involving the murder of a little 9-year-old girl. And I covered those trials, and it was very difficult to write about. So by the time I got done with that, I really needed to do something different, and I wanted to, like I said...
And to cleanse the palate.
Yeah, and I wanted to do something positive. So, and I had been working on this Orca book for a long time, so it was time to do the Orca book. I think a lot of it is that I've never written a book that wasn't something I really wanted to do. And I don't think it's possible to write a whole book without it being something you really want to do. So, you know, follow your passion when it comes to these projects. Use your instincts, because all of my, yeah, they haven't sold well, but they all got published, you know.
And they were finished, and you're proud of them.
Yeah, yeah, and I am proud of them. I still think, you know, I do think the eliminationists really kind of forecast what was happening with, is happening today with Donald Trump and that whole phenomenon. I think it's unfortunate that people weren't paying attention and still really aren't. Let's just put it this way. The one thing I regret is just kind of being right too soon. I think you can be out in front of the curve, out in front of the wave a little too far. I feel like maybe I was a little too far in front of the wave.
So timing is everything.
Yeah, I think timing's a lot of it, but at the same time, I don't regret any of it, and it's been really a good life, and I've enjoyed doing all of my projects, and I'm proud of all of them. They're like children to me. And I think that that's how you have to do it. It has to be something you love. It has to be something you want to write about. It has to be something you care about. That's the beginning. I mean, that's going to be the fuel, what you have to do to build a career as a good reporter, is you have to have a good basis of caring about the facts, trying to convey the broader truth of a story as well as you can, both through factuality and through sort of how you, the context that you provide. And that's always been, I would say that that's the basis of the kind of journalism that I've tried to do over the years.
And that's a whole conversation there, too, yeah. I mean, about the death of journalism school,
yeah.
that the problems there with the types of reporters and their training, and the death of the local old school newspaper.
Yeah.
And now everybody's they're signing up for, you know, the wire services. They don't have people working the beat. They don't pay anybody a living wage.
No.
And we're missing out on a whole, you know, again, that fourth estate and how it's changed. And the idea of the tradition of sitting down, like my mother and father, I'm sure yours probably did, grandparents, and you get the daily paper and you read it.
Well, yeah, and it's actually, and what it's really degraded, I think, as much as anything, is the sense of community in America. It's just completely vanished, especially out in rural America, because nobody, and in a lot of ways, the newspaper is just a reflection of that. It's a reflection of the whole Walmartization of the rural economies and that sort of, but definitely a part of that picture that we've lost our sense of community because we don't really have the community paper anymore.
And the community paper is yeah. part of the public square,
yeah.
the commons.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
yeah.
But since you mentioned it earlier, I got to ask. So you mentioned obituaries.
Uh-huh.
What is the trick to writing a good obituary or a bad one? I mean, do you have any ones that jump out where you're just like, this is the worst obituary I've ever seen? Because one thing I've noticed, and maybe older folks read the obituaries to be happy that people they know are dead and they're still alive. Like they outlasted them or something? Or maybe like you're just legitimately curious to look at the obituaries. Because one thing I've noticed is when people die suddenly, the obituaries tend to be really, really, really long.
yeah.
And I was like, yeah, that must maybe this is the shock, and they want to get this person's life on the page. But do you have any obituary stories?
Oh, no.
Or tips or tricks for writing them?
No, I hadn't thought, you know, I haven't thought about obituaries in a long time other than that they were some of the trickiest writing to do because you had to make sure that you didn't make the family unhappy. And a lot of times, and it's kind of unfortunate, you don't get those obituaries anymore that are written by a staff member. The obituaries you read now are written by a family member. But when I was coming up in newspapers, all the obituaries were written by a member of the staff, taken from information provided by the funeral homes who got it from the families. Sometimes information would get bollocked up in that transmission process, and at other times we just had standards doing those obituaries we had to do, such as we needed to have cause of death, we needed to know the date of their birth and the date of their death, you know, just the basic statistical stuff that you should have in every obituary. And a lot of that stuff is missing totally from obituaries now, because they're being written by family members who don't want to give away a person's age. And, you know.
And they put the picture of them when they were 30
yeah.
when they were 90.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the picture I want, damn it. I'm not happy with how I look now, that's for sure, now that I'm getting up there in years. It was actually, the main thing I remember about doing obits is that it really taught me to tread carefully with death in the family, because these are people's most sensitive moments, and you have to work with compassion. And so you're putting something, you're really creating a product that's kind of anodyne and sterile, because it has to be, but you also have to be deeply sympathetic at the time you're doing it. It was kind of an interesting exercise.
You know, hopefully my obit is written far off in the future, or I will leave this earth when fate and Crom and the universe decide, whenever that may be. But I hope whoever writes my obit would be like, you know, follow the old dictum or edict that you don't let, I don't know if it was Mark Twain who said it, don't let the truth get in the way of a good story. I have permission to embellish the facts.
Yes.
When they write my obituary. Embellish, embellish away. But David, what do you have coming up in terms of work projects? Where can folks find you online, email you, contact, all that good stuff?
You'll find my work at Hate Watch, the Southern Poverty Law Center's blog. I don't post every day. Actually, I tend to post about once a week. Other than that, I also put together the blog's daily Hate Watch headlines. So when you read those, you're actually reading my little daily compilations. And I still have my blog at Orsinus, which is at dneiwert.blogspot.com. You know, I have a Facebook page for Of Orcas and Men. People can go there and visit it and check out the photos and the slides. And I've got some sound files there that you can listen to what orcas sound like. And right now I'm, you know, I've been focusing on going out and selling the whale book. And it's been kind of interesting because I'm moving in a quite a different world than the one I've moved in for the last 10, 15 years. Not very as political. There's a lot more crazy cat ladies, I think. But
cool, David. I want to thank you, man. I mean, it's so much good sharing. We got killer whales, obituaries, white nationalists, white supremacists.
Yeah.
Journalism and all sorts of other, and Donald Trump.
Yeah.
I consider that a good conversation.
I get asked a lot, you know, what's the connection between killer whales and hate groups? It's not immediately obvious, but what I will say is this. The people who do killer whales in captivity are very much participating in the sort of system of dominance and control that has typified the far right and Western civilization for most of its history. There's a reason it's so cult-like, and the tactics that they use to attack their critics are very much like those that we see in bizarre cults. But more than that, I think the sort of rethinking of our place in the world that we need to do in order to save ourselves as a species is it's very similar to what we saw when we rethought the whole role of white supremacy in society. The man who probably invented multiculturalism, Franz Boas, was a man who worked with the Kwakutl tribe in an early career. Kwakutl tribe was very closely affiliated with killer whales, and I talk about them quite a bit in my book. They revered killer whales, saw them as ancestors, and that sort of thing. So, and they actually had matriarchal tribes, which is what put Boas on the path of debunking sort of Darwinistic evolution ideas and evolving the ideas of multiculturalism. So I think similar evolution is sort of in store for us as a species in terms of how we think about our place in nature as well. So.
And we need that paradigm shift in order to survive.
Yes.
That's for sure.
Exactly. Exactly.
That's for sure. But, David, I want to thank you for sitting down and chatting. I mean, I know you're super busy.
Yeah.
You're out there in the Northwest. And like I said, maybe in the future, in other projects, sit down and chat again as this Donald Trump human zoo continues.
But yeah.
Longtime fan of your work, and I want to thank you one more time for the support you showed to my work through Crooks and Liars and Elsewhere. It was really, really appreciated.
Well, really a pleasure, Chauncey, and best of luck to you.
All right. Thanks a lot.
All right.
I want to thank Dave one more time. Great episode for the first installment in our fundraising month. You see, I keep repeating fundraising because through repetition, you keep people engaged and you prime them to make donations to support your many hours of work a week on the show. So no guilt there. Just doing my NPR thing, folks. So Dave, as I said, I just want to thank him one more time for sharing. And I'm just reflecting again about what he said. He said, if you really like something and it's calling you and it's your passion project, you're writing, you got to do it. Even if, as he was very self-deprecating, by the way, his books are very, very widely read and influential in many circles. So that's how you know the dude's a heavy hitter and a serious player, because he can make those types of jokes. That you just got to do it. That's it. You got to say, this story needs to be told. Fiction or nonfiction, this argument needs to be advanced. The research needs to be completed. These characters need to be unleashed upon the world. And you may get paid, you'll probably lose money on it, but you got to do it. And I think that was just great advice about chopping that tree every day that I'm going to redouble down on in my own life. Because, of course, I love doing the great sharing here on the podcast and bringing these great folks to all of you. But, hell, I'm selfish, too. I like learning from people and bringing folks on that can have a direct and immediate impact in terms of my own thinking, too. It giving me some life and trade advice. So I want to thank Dave one more time. Whew. It's still cold, people. I've now had this damn electric heat on, which is running too much money every month. What sort of society is this? First world problems, I guess. The homeless brothers and sisters be like, Chauncey, shut up, I'm on the street. Heat up, damn it. Heat up. My melanin can't keep up with the cold. I want to talk very quick. I know you roll your eyes sometimes when I've got great guests like Irv Muchnick on. You should check out that podcast. He and I talked professional wrestling, sports identity. David Reese, he and I talked professional wrestling. Going to have some future folks on talking about the business inside the square circle too, but very quick promo / observation, because I know I'm not the only pro wrestling fan out there. And also a quick observation about my beloved New England Patriots and how they got screwed, held down, fisted, destroyed, cheated by the referees. Man, I'm mad about that. We're going to get our revenge on them Broncos. They can gloat for now. Oh, laugh and gloat, Broncos. laugh and gloat that you can beat the Patriots with the help of the referees with all the Patriots players laid out in the Gronk monster. Thank goodness his leg ain't broke. Laid out too. So pro wrestling complaint. Mick Foley, the one and only Mick Foley, should read his many New York Times bestselling books. He's a wonderful writer. Wonderful writer. He's been talking online about not watching WWE Raw anymore. I don't know if he just meant the whole product or just the show. The show's really been in the stinker lately, and I've been fast-forwarding more than I have been watching. It's a three-hour show, which is entirely too long. Seth Rollins is hurt. Daniel Bryan, I hope he doesn't ever wrestle again. He's too injured. They're saying he could be crippled. We don't need to see that. You've got other Cesaro is apparently hurt. So you have Roman Reigns, who should just turn heel already. When people want to boo a person, let them boo him, please. Still forcing him down everybody's throat. And you have Sheamus at the last pay-per-view, Survivor Series, win the belt. He cashed in the Money in the Bank. So you had that tournament, and Ambrose could have turned too. You could have done something interesting or exciting. So you have the predictable finish, right? And then you have the first episode back. And the women have been doing a little better with their wrestling. And I'm not a booker. I'm a lifelong fan of professional wrestling. I like to think I know about more about the wrestling business than the average smart mark. As I always say, I was lucky enough to be interviewed for a job at WWE. My claim to fame. And this is an intelligent consumer of popular culture and someone who admires pro wrestling as an art form, as physical storytelling. It's drama. It's drama. I'm really frustrated. So you have Sheamus win. And for folks who aren't in pro wrestling, the whole point, we like the mythical storytelling, good versus evil. We follow characters. We like the athleticism. And you get attached to the storylines. And like I was telling Irv Munchak, he and I were talking, we have seen these stories all before, people. But we're interested in how the person innovates on it. So the first show back, when dude has the belt, you have a match with Roman Reigns, where they basically say it's going to be a 5-minute, 36-second match, something like that, the amount of time that Roman Reigns had the belt. It's a gimmick match. And you're going to have your champion, who people don't want to support anyway, come out and look even weaker than normal by having to, like, sort of cheat and not even be able to last the 5 minutes with the challenger in his first real title defense that's on TV. A child could have written something better than that. We're supposed to book him strong, make him an ass kicker, make him a destroyer, or just keep him away from Roman Reigns. But no. Crappy writing. And I'm like Mick Foley, who's now saying he's going to start watching again. His son got a job writing for WWE, and I guess his daughter's going to be working for him too. So maybe the whole thing was just a work on the rest of us. But I don't think Mick Foley would do that. He doesn't seem, he's a businessman first, of course. Respect for the business first. There's a twin first there, but I just don't think he would do that to folk. His writing was too heartfelt. So I don't know if I'm the only one frustrated by WWE, but they got to fix it because their ratings are down. Compelling characters with matches that mean something and create some drama. That's all. In every match, and the thing they did with Rusev and Lana, by the way, people, now I'm in a wrestling rant. You have a monster Bulgarian legit badass who's an ass-kicking machine. Now he's with his real-life fiance / soon-to-be wife. They announce it and ruin the character. And instead of having him be a monstrous brute, they broke him up, got him back together. Now they're going to be married in real life. The character has just lost all his heat. He just have him be a monster. Other people said this, not my idea. Who has total disdain for all Americans. And have her do the promos because she's a sexy ice goddess. And just channel that heat and just make people hate his guts. Do the Putin thing he was doing before. But no, they totally make him do a teddy bear who's in love, who's up there kissing his woman on the stage. I don't know. Quickly, I'm so mad. New England Patriots were defeated, right? Beaten by the referees. The referees in general stink this season. ESPN had a piece, I think. New England Sports Network had something on it. Bleacher Report, a few of the other sports websites. I don't know if Esquire, their guy, wrote about this. But the refs have been really bad. Blowing horrendous calls. And the whole thing is that they're not real employees of the NFL. Some of them are really inexperienced. They've been changing the rules a lot, and people are just making dumb mistakes. And this was said years ago, and maybe it's bearing fruit, that having instant replay actually has created more pressure on the referees. So instead of forcing them to be more accurate, it's making them less accurate. But that Patriots game, Gronkowski hurt. Amendola's sitting his butt down. The running back guy is out. We've hurt people hurt on the defense. The Colts did not beat the Patriots. I'm sorry, I'm not bellyaching as a Pats fan. The referees beat the Patriots. Gronkowski alone has been called for, I think, six offensive passing interference penalties or more which is if he was a team, this is one man, would be number two in the league. They are calling them on every minor thing, not letting people play, and then not calling obvious penalties against the other team. This cost the Patriots at least a touchdown, maybe two, certainly a first down. And it's just disgusting to watch. I don't think the refs are being paid off, but nothing would surprise me. Maybe I don't think they're gambling like these NBA refs were doing years ago when they wrote a book about it and they got called out and the NBA snuffed that book quick. I think they bought every copy of the book and pulped it. Maybe there's an environment from the top down saying punish the Patriots. But then I'm not a stats math football guy, so someone can email me chauncey@vega.com and help me understand. Maybe there's something going on with the stats where winning teams or teams that are perceived to be too good are penalized more than teams that are perceived to be weak, or maybe I'm getting the causal errors back. Maybe super good teams are penalized less, or maybe it's certain players are protected and others are punished. I don't know. But the referees should never, ever decide a game. Not in the way they've been blowing whistles at the wrong times, messing up the clocks, calling interference that ain't there. So I'm sure someone who's doing a math stat football sporting geek guy or gal has done this, but I'd love to see a chart where somebody does some basic math on all the sports data for the NFL this season, and you divide up obvious penalties that there's no discretion involved, encroachment or something like that, offsides, obvious things, and see sort of the average number of calls, yards, see if it's fair across the league. And then you look at categories of penalties which are more discretion-oriented, passing interference, things like that, and then see which teams are being penalized more relative to the mean. I bet the Patriots are getting their asses kicked on that second category where there's any discretion allowed. And I think that's going to tell us something systematically about what's going on with this league. I think maybe that's coming from the top down to punish the Patriots. I don't know. I'm done. Let me stop the rant. I'm going to resist the black cherry. I'm warming up. I'm feeling good. And I do, as I said, you know, it's fundraising. And I got to go back one more time. Thank the people who have donated. We've had a few donors so far for the podcast, for the website, chauncevega.com, the PayPal link at chauncevega.com on the right-hand sidebar. I want to thank all of them. As always, I want to thank folks who download, tweet, and share the podcast. That means a lot. Please, as I said, a few folks have done it. When you get to iTunes, if you can click on that star ranking for the podcast and the shows, that would mean a lot. That helps to get us visibility. If you can write a comment or two, I know it takes time. I know. Take 30 seconds and write something about the show, good or negative. Give me some suggestions, guests you would like to see. That would be very, very, very much appreciated. As I said, we've got next week, second week of the podcast, fundraiser, the great, and I mean that, accessible, smart, funny, and just real people. You ever just talk to people and they're real? Real folk. And we talk, you know, before and after we do a podcast, we do a little pre-conversation, and we talk sometimes a little bit afterwards, never makes the show. Just two wonderful people that I like to hang out with and have a beer with, or two or three. So the authors of The American Slave Coast, A History of the Slave Breeding Industry. Yes, I said slave breeding industry. So I said a tough conversation, folks, next week, but one that will enrich you, that you will learn a lot from. And I've read the book, shaken and moved. I read the book and I was like, it synthesized so many things I'd known, brought together a lot of scholarship that had been considered on the periphery, and they just do a lot of new work, too, in terms of access to archives. Get that book. Get it. Get it for somebody for Christmas. Get it for somebody. Get it for yourself. Ned and Constance Sublett. Next week for round two on this fundraiser month, December, of the eponymously named podcast known as the Chauncey Devega Show. As I said, please, if you can, throw some change in that begging bowl. Podcast takes a lot of time. The writing takes a lot of time. And it's both the material support for opportunity costs, which I will put to very good use, as you heard me earlier, and the symbolic energy, because those donations are a way of assessing how well we're doing. You know, as I said, no shame, no guilt if you can. Take care of your responsibilities. But if you could include a brother in the show and his various other work on the shopping list, the Christmas list for $1, $2, $5, $10, $20, $50, I've had some very generous donors. Nothing but love from me on that. So, as we always do at the end of our podcast, be it fundraiser or not, be it my cold apartment or not, be it black cherry soda or not. I'll one more. I'm sorry. I can't resist. Hold on. So good to close the show with black cherry. Please, take care of yourself. Practice mental self-care. Please try to reach out to a homeless brother or sister. It's hard, especially these holidays. Please, we got to get together and make sure every child has a gift for Christmas. Give to the Salvation Army. Give to Toys to Tots if you can. make sure, you know, if you got a used jacket or warm shoes, they don't have holes in them, a sweater, use good used clothes. A lot of homeless shelters, halfway houses, battered women's shelters, family shelters are doing that. So let's go through the things that we have that we don't wear anymore, folks, and try to do some sharing in that regard. Please try to reach out to our semi-residents, as I said, homeless brothers and sisters who are out there on these streets. It's cold, it's dangerous, it's a hard life. Please try to show them some love if you can, even if it's a conversation and a sandwich. Even if it's how are you doing today, even if it's 5 minutes of your time just to talk to somebody. Acknowledge their humanity if you can. Please try to take care of our animal friends, you know that. Doggy friends, cat friends, winged friend, reptilian friend, fish friend, insect friend. My insect friend is still here. There was a daddy long legs I saw yesterday trying to sneak. I said, brother, daddy long legs, now if you hide in the corner and I don't see you, you're all right. But he couldn't obey the rules. You know, I will never take a life. So I had to put him in a cup and put him out in the hall and tell him you can't follow the rules. Now, when you can follow the rules, daddy long legs, because it's cold, you can come hide behind the boxes near the refrigerator. But if you can't, you got to stay out in the hall. Thank you, daddy long legs. We'll see if he respects me. But all of our variety of friends, domestic animal friends, outside animal friends, our squirrel friends, our birdie friends, save them some bread, save some cookies for them, and take care of them in these cold winters. And as I always say at the end of the podcast, please reach out to someone you've had a falling out with, you had an argument with, you have not talked to for whatever reason. Maybe just time pushed you guys apart. Maybe you had a fight. Maybe it was something big at the time that in hindsight was little. Maybe it was something little that one or two of the parties blew up into something big. Maybe the person has pain and they were lashing out at you because of their pain. Because, you know, sometimes people hurt the people closest to them. It happens all the time. So please, this holiday season, or not even for the holidays, anytime, pick somebody or two people you had a falling out with and email them. Call them. Send a real physical letter. Because then they got to open it, right? It's a real thing. Please try to do that. And reconnect and say, you know, you at least tried to take the high road. You tried to do the right thing. You tried to be righteous. So as is my standard closing, I want to thank you again for listening to, downloading, tweeting, and sharing the Eponymous Indian Podcast. I want to thank Dave Neiwert one more time for his great teaching, his great sharing, his generosity with his time. And next week, the authors of the American Slave Coast here on the Eponymously Named Podcast, known as the Chauncey Devega Show. Be safe and be well. Until next time.